Welcome to Trends with Benefits, an award-winning podcast by Van Eck with a forward-looking perspective. We explore new ways of thinking about the markets, work, and life. Here's your host, Ed Lopez.
Hey, Jared. Welcome to the show.
Hey, Ed. I'm glad to be with you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. I've been looking forward to this. And just kind of given your scope of the world, I guess, I think we could go a lot of different places here. I caught your CNBC spot on artificial intelligence. I think you also had written some work on AI and how to play that theme and you know, with ETFs. So maybe we could talk a little bit about that. And I don't know, what was the what was your motivation for putting out that piece on AI? Was it just a kind of a concern for how people try to approach it, or?
Yes, I mean, I guess two things. Productivity in the United States is incredibly low right now. I think it's at one of the lowest levels of productivity growth in an incredibly long time. And the economists at B of A Research tell us that that has a lot to do with measurement issues, shift towards services and other things that are more labor intensive. I'm sure that that's true, and that's a good explanation. It's still a very low level of productivity, and the trend growth, more importantly, in U.S. productivity is incredibly low. And so if you take many, many steps away from the day-to-day of financial markets and think about why we invest in different places, why we would invest in equities as opposed to bonds, for example, and other things. A lot of that has to do with prospects for higher growth, higher productivity. And so when it's low, it becomes more difficult to make a plausible case to invest in anything with meaningful risk involved. And yet people are very optimistic, some investors very optimistic, that artificial intelligence will spark a productivity boom. So the reason we wanted to write about that topic, to look at the broad macro picture as we did in one report, and then look at ETFs to express that view in a separate piece, where number one, to respond to just massive investor interest in the topic, you know, people who were excited about this theme and want to find companies that might give them exposure to that opportunity. But then more importantly, from my view, to try to understand why productivity is important and why artificial intelligence might cause a surge in productivity, and then actually try to assess the case whether that's likely or not. That's what we tried to do in that work.
Did you come to a conclusion? Do you think that AI will help productivity?
We expect both sides. You know, if you think this is, the way we put it is, there have been a few different genuine booms in productivity in U.S. history. You know, three, if you follow the economist Robert Gordon, who's a fantastic economist, and he notes, you know, you have the steam engine, railroads related to that. That was a big one, you know, 100 years ago. Electricity then, and what that meant as it was adopted across the economy. And then finally, computers in the 90s and early 2000s with networking and the internet and so on. Those are the three big ones. They all saw a surge from trend productivity growth around 1% to 2% and was associated with some really big economic expansions. Well, our conclusion was, if you think that artificial intelligence is another one of those, if it's transformational, then you should absolutely invest in the theme and prepare for some big changes. On the other hand, for every one productivity boom, you can think of moments of enthusiasm, we could say. I won't say hype, but periods where investors become incredibly optimistic about some new technology that doesn't pan out quite in the way that they thought. Still valuable, still profitable from an investment standpoint, but not transformational, something more marginal. So our conclusion was, if you think AI is transformational, here's one way to invest: buy the companies, the hardware and the software firms that will provide this to every other industry as everyone adopts these models. If, however, you think AI is going to be more marginal as a technology, or maybe the rollout takes a long time, maybe the use cases are not as widespread as people think, then you should invest accordingly, which means invest in companies that are able to incorporate these technologies into their business to become more profitable, rather than looking for a hardware-driven, you know, source of returns. My conclusion: I'm a little bit skeptical. I think that looking at the valuations, the profit potential especially in the hardware and the software side, it requires a lot to go right and a lot to go right very quickly. I keep thinking of the quote from Scott McNeely, the CEO of Sun Microsystems, several decades ago, and he was talking about when people were buying shares of Sun during the dot-com boom at 10 times revenues. And he said, I'm paraphrasing, but the gist of it was, when you're buying our firm at 10 times revenue, assuming that we just pay all of our revenue back to you as shareholders over the next 10 years, then you'll be made whole. 10-year break-even, you get your money back, and then presumably some profits from there. But that requires that we have no capital expenditures. It requires that we pay no taxes. That's not legal. It requires that you pay no taxes, not legal. It requires that we don't pay our employees any. I mean, you know, the list goes on. 10 times revenue. And the big famous quote is, what were you thinking? He asked people, because what were they thinking? And if you look at some of the firms that are talked about a lot in artificial intelligence today, you can find examples. I won't name names, but you can find examples that are trading at 15 times revenue. There's one company I can think of trading at 35 times revenue. And it doesn't mean they're going to crash. It doesn't mean even that they'll underperform. It just means that expectations are so high that everything has to go right, I think, with that theme for those particular stocks to continue to be compounders and sources of great returns the way that they have been over the past 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, that makes sense. Maybe there's better opportunities for your capital other than some overvalued or highly valued securities currently in that space.
Well, one of the things that I enjoyed so much working on this topic was learning about companies, sometimes very small companies, but firms that had been able to use artificial intelligence already to transform their business. There's one company that is in recycling and waste management. If you know about processing, you know, recycled material, it's historically been really labor intensive. You just have human beings, there's a conveyor belt and there's all the material, you know, passing on by, and they pick out things that have to go, you know, can't be recycled or one way or the other. Not a good job, low, you know, not a very profitable thing to do. And they used visual AI models with cameras and some machines to turn that into a completely mechanized automated process with great success and massively profitable. In fact, we identified 10 or so companies that had already been using AI today and had outperformed the S&P 500 over the past 10 years. And none of these were the big, you know, growth stocks that everyone thinks of, the Microsofts and Googles and so on. These are small, some large, but firms away from that area that had already been using this in their business. And I think that's pretty exciting on a longer term view.
At some point, a lot of companies will be using some form of AI to improve their processes. But right now, is it more of a quality screen, or kind of you really have to get into the business to understand how they're doing it? Because it doesn't, you couldn't really index a lot of this unless you're just focused on hardware, right? Because, like, you know, when we do some indexing, we look at companies that generate more than 50% of their revenue from that particular theme, like AI. But you can't necessarily do that with a retail play, could you?
It's very difficult. In fact, some people have even been accused of, you know, AI washing, not whitewashing, but, you know, AI washing, because they're, yeah, you know, there, it's almost a joke sometimes the way you can look at company comments during earnings calls each quarter, and you can see which ones have been speaking about artificial intelligence for years on a regular basis, and you can see which companies just started talking about it in the last one or two quarters. And it's very suspicious when the mentions go from 000 to 20. It is a challenge, as you say, for indexing and for creating ETFs. This is one of the things that we wrote about. If you go too broad, you end up with companies in your, what is ostensibly an AI ETF, that only marginally have anything to do with the topic. That's not a well-designed index from our perspective. And so pure plays are interesting. And that's why we say, if you think AI is transformational, you can buy the ETFs that really capture the theme that are pure plays. If you think it's more marginal, then you do have to do more homework. You've got to find the firms that are actually implementing this in a robust way, and that requires more work, but also I think is a better, probably give you a better moat and opportunity in terms of returns.
Well, awesome. I knew you'd have a lot to say on AI and technology. If you're not watching the video, you just heard me introduce a guy named Jared, but so just so you know who I'm talking to, I'm talking to Jared Woodard, head of the Research Investment Committee at BofA Securities. It's really great to have him on the show to talk about so many different things. One of the things I wanted to talk to you about, and we'll get there, is some of your recent work on the transition from a 2% to 5% world and the 60-40 portfolio and how that all interacts. But currently, as we're speaking, a couple things have come in terms of inflation and both on consumer and producer price inputs. I was just wondering, because those have kind of come in lower now. I think the core CPI is 3% as of June, getting closer to the Fed's target. I don't know, what does that say to you, if anything? Is that now bullish for stocks, or do you have a different outlook in terms of where we are in the economy?
Well, in the very short term, Ed, the improvement in inflation numbers, I think it is Well, it's been greeted by great news. You've seen markets rally. And I think that, you know, investors are coming to understand that the business cycle still exists and nothing lasts forever. And trends can moderate and then reverse and so on, like with always. I mean, I don't, anyone who expected that high rates of growth of inflation would continue unendingly. I think the obsession sometimes with details of monthly releases can get a little overdone. I mean, I think it's important to recognize that the incredible surge in prices over the past several years is still with us. The fact that prices are only growing at 3% instead of 4%, it's not bad news. It's good news for just about everyone. It remains to be the case that prices are still rising at 3%, or if you look at a core measure, you know, 4, maybe 4.5 or 5. And these are serious numbers no matter where they are. I don't know anyone who expects a quick return necessarily to Goldilocks just because the Federal Reserve may not have to hike interest rates that much further. Again, that's good news on the margin, but the level of prices is still incredibly high. Prices are still growing at a rate that's much faster than the average of the past couple decades. And so even in these periods where maybe inflation cools a little bit, if we meet, you know, again, a year from now, it may be that the Federal Reserve is discussing when it's time to cut interest rates if they haven't done so already. That's all very possible. But our longer term view is that the business cycle exists, fluctuations month to month and year to year still exist, but that the long term trends are actually the aberration from the even longer term normal over the past 100 years.
Do you think there's another shoe to drop in terms of corporate profit margins in the second half? I mean, after an aggressive rate hiking cycle, the economy still seems good. Profit margins are good. People are employed. Everything seems good. But has that played out yet? Are we still to wait to see profit margins to start to squeeze and perhaps drop off by the end of the year in equity markets?
The consensus across analysts on Wall Street is that the S&P 500 over the next 12 months, let's say, we'll see profits decline by about 3%. I think at Bank of America, our colleagues, at least for the United States, are a little bit more bullish than that. But it's not a call for really sharp growth in profits either. So there's some debate and contention, in other words, about the path of profits, whether it'll be slightly positive or slightly negative. I don't think anyone has a really strong view on something more extreme than that in either case, very strong or very weak. But there's a sense certainly that it's too early to suggest that the fastest interest rate hiking cycle in history won't have an effect on the real economy, won't have an effect on profit. The jury's still out, and the Fed's constantly pains to remind us that what they call the long and variable lags between policy decisions and their effects in the real economy. I mean, we're going to have to wait a little bit longer to see just what the full effects of this will be on the real economy as the Fed, you know, has raised interest rates so quickly and may continue to do so a little bit more.
Does demographics come into your research at all? And are you foreseeing a change, a different landscape, just kind of given retirement of baby boomers and tighter labor supply? Have things changed for you going forward the next 10 years, 20 years?
Well, okay, demographics is incredibly important. I think it's one of the most overlooked factors that affect economic growth and prospects for investment returns. And that, well, let's just say the very gloomy picture on demographics in most countries is something that investors haven't yet been forced to admit. But maybe before getting into the details on that, it's a nice moment to put that piece, that demographic piece of the puzzle, into the larger context for us, which is of a 2% world versus a 5% world. Over the past couple decades, I've mentioned a few times the last 20 years as a particularly interesting period, because you had that Goldilocks period of low inflation but overall, you know, decent economic growth and stable profits, interest rates, you know, incredibly low, at record lows, in fact, liquidity at record highs, and this what we call the 2% world of the past couple decades, many of the major economic variables averaged across developed economies around that level. Real GDP growth around 2%, the Fed funds target at 2%, inflation, you know, wage growth, different measures around that level. When we look not over the past 20 years, but over the past, say, 100 years in the United States and some other economies, what we find is that the average for those major macroeconomic variables is much closer to 5%, not 2%. So when we think about inflation, and again, I completely recognize and would even emphasize that there are still cycles, the business cycle still with us, which means big fluctuations around a longer term trend. Our contention, though, is that the longer term trend for interest rates and for inflation over the coming years and even possibly decades is likely to be significantly higher. That the long-term average for these big variables is more like 5%. And we should expect that when it comes to asset allocation decisions, forming portfolios, making big investments, we should start to think about the cost of capital, about inflation, about interest rates, and these other variables more in a 5% context, because investors haven't had to do that for an incredibly long time. Most portfolios, most asset allocation models, most discounted cash flow models, and you know, even individual analyst company models assume cost of capital and interest rates and other major variables based on the very recent past. And I think that might prove to be a mistake as the years go on, because if you do see structurally higher inflation and interest rates, then the kinds of assets where you would prioritize can be very different.
So I should probably refinance an ARM, right? An ARM mortgage. Just level that out.
Maybe not today. It's if you got in at 3%, you know, the 6%, 7% today doesn't look great, but I do think that you know, more directly when it comes to financial assets, the long-term government bonds, even high so-called high quality corporate bonds may not be paying you the kind of yield on a, let's say, 2 to 5 year view that you would expect in real terms, because unless inflation craters sharply and stays incredibly low, unless the Federal Reserve cuts interest rates just as sharply as they've raised them, some of those portfolios that are buying very low yielding assets with very high sensitivity to interest rates may be much more volatile than people expect. I mean, 2022 was the best possible proof of this view, something that we've been writing about for years now. You saw stocks decline 18%, I think, for the S&P 500. Long-term treasuries fell by 30% on a mark-to-market basis. Not the kind of volatility that people expect when they allocate to those big familiar assets.
Yeah. So are you basically saying you would see an inverted yield curve for some time to come?
Well, I mean, I think that the yield curve can move with the business cycle and with Fed policy the way it has always done. You know, so if the Federal Reserve, it does end up, let's say they are cutting interest rates by this time next year, the market will have figured that out, you know, in advance. We'll have started to trade on that basis even before that. And so you can see the curve steepening. It would be confirmation for us that a recession, you know, was coming. I think you'll still see business cycles. But our broader point is that if you take the average over a bit longer time frame rather than month to month or quarter to quarter, it does seem very unlikely that we get back to, you know, a 0% Fed funds rate, or that we see 10-year Treasury bonds yielding, I think it was 0.7% at one point during COVID. I think, in other words, you know, you hate to say some kind of generational call, but it may very well be that the generational low is in for bond yields and inflation and interest rates. And so even if there are cycles in which they cut, in which bonds rally as yields decline, that you'll see succession of higher lows as time goes on.
Let's talk about your take on the 60-40 portfolio. I think you said the 60 portfolio is at an end or has ended, but I thought maybe it died a few years back. And now with interest rates higher and yields generally higher, depending on, I guess, where you're targeting, maybe there was an opportunity then to reinstate the 60-40. Am I wrong about that?
Well, yeah, we kind of called time a number of years ago. You know, there are these zombie moments, I suppose you could say, when it comes back. But the view essentially is that if you're using a conventional model portfolio, conventional asset allocation mix, something like 60% equities, 40% bonds, especially government bonds, has been the default template for many investors for a long time. That template worked, you know, to some extent. I mean, it made sense at least. And it's been in the literature. They'll teach it in schools. But if you look a bit broader, if you look a little bit more longer term, then you would get a different result in your asset allocation model. And so I think that the biggest takeaway for investors is both the 60 in the equities and the 40, if it's government bonds or even investment grade corporate bonds, require a bit of a rethink based on this idea of a 2% to 5% world. In the case of bonds, if interest rates and inflation are going to be higher on a trend basis, and you're putting money away for retirement, or you don't plan to touch it for 5 years or something like that, you may be exposed to much more risk with much lower returns in investment grade corporates or government bonds or other very rate sensitive assets than the model would predict. And that 30% drawdown in treasuries in 2022 is just one example. Even in the past 5 to 10 years, actually, interest rate volatility has been much, much higher than it has over the longer term. on the equity side, it's actually a similar story. The concentration in equity markets is something many people are talking about these days. It's well understood, I think. You know, the top, whatever, the top, you know, six or seven stocks are comprising 30% of the market cap of the S&P 500. We've done some work on this. We found that it's the 30-year anniversary of ETFs, by the way, which we cover. And so we looked at, if you bought the first ETF tracking the S&P 500 30 years ago, what did you get for your money? Well, we found it was a pretty good, pretty diversified investment. The average correlation 30 years ago of the stocks and the index to one another was something like 10 or 12%. And so that's what you want as a diversified investor. You want individual businesses to rise or fall according to their own success, and a broad basket of them will give you, you know, some uplift over time. But as concentrations increased in the index, as liquidity is pushed in more investors, as valuations gotten higher, lots of factors we might identify, but the bottom line is that the correlation among individual constituents of the S&P 500 to one another is now more like 50%, not 10%. In a crisis, it can be 80 or even 90%. So you're not getting the kind of diversification, even through an index or an ETF of many different equities, that you once had. The big drivers are more concentrated together, they occupy a larger share. The rest of the constituents are more correlated. Valuations are high. If these sound like reasons not to buy the S&P 500, I think they are. I mean, the only problem is that if you look at a year like this year, if you weren't in those concentrated, dominant, you know, handful of stocks, I mean, the S&P 500, excluding the tech sector, is basically flat for the year with those tech stocks who've done really well. And it presents an incredibly difficult challenge for investors who want to be driven by sound, rational decision-making, but then are confronted with returns that push them in the other direction. All I can tell you is that when we've looked at similar periods in history, when valuations are high, concentration is high, sentiment is very bullish, some of these metrics seem like they're broken forever. Well, those periods were the Nifty 50 stocks in the 1970s, the dot-com bubble in the early 2000s. I don't think we're quite at those extremes yet in terms of valuation in either case, but I do know that, I mean, even in the 70s, we put together a historical index getting single stock level back in those days and kind of created a Nifty 50 basket from the historical data. What we found is that if you bought those high growth blue chip companies back in the 70s when everyone, you know, felt, well, we just have to own them, as those companies matured, as the Federal Reserve hiked rates, as the economy slowed, many of those stocks sold off and didn't recover for a decade or more. I mean, it was dead money for a decade. Many of the ones that did survive matured from high growth companies into more mature value companies, from, you know, fast growing market leaders to dividend paying, you know, sort of sleepy, more mature companies. IBM, for example. I think that may be the future for some of the dominant companies today. The point is that on the 60% side of your portfolio, valuation still matters for a long-term investor. Where the earnings come from, you know, still matters, and diversification is still more important than ever. So when your index products, your index ETF or mutual fund or whatever it might be, is not giving you the diversification that you thought it was, then I think our advice is actually use ETFs to augment a core portfolio to achieve the kind of diversification and breadth that might be missing otherwise. And the same thing's true in fixed income. You know, it's not just that the 40% in government bonds or investment grade corporates is unattractive. I think it is. The solution is what? Well, I think you can augment those core portfolio holdings using ETFs or some other product to achieve more diversification, higher level of yield, and less exposure to interest rates than a conventional benchmark or conventional model or portfolio would have you do.
Yeah, you write about concentration and fixed income indices, in particular concentration in particular sectors, which I thought was interesting. You have concentration in equities, concentration in fixed income. So you're making the argument to diversify away from that. It seems like you could be making an argument for more smart beta type strategies if you're using ETFs, or even active management, mutual funds, ETFs of that sort.
That's right. The concentration in some of the very familiar bond benchmarks has you, I think, something like 70% of the assets in investment grade corporates and or government bonds. So very low levels of yield, very high levels of interest rate risk and interest rate volatility. You can achieve higher levels of yield, more diversification by adding some parts of the fixed income market that investors often don't think of. We're a big fan of fallen angel corporate bonds, for example, that highest quality tranche of high yield corporates, which historically has given you better returns, better risk-adjusted returns than just about any other part of the corporate bond market. targeting those specifically has been incredibly attractive historically. We think emerging market debt has its place. Leverage loans for much of the business cycle are a great place to be. And there's a few others. We have one strategy we talk about. We call it prudent yield. You want more yield. You want to be prudent about it. Don't just plow everything into triple C, you know, high yield corporates. But you can
don't
achieve.
Don't just chase yield.
Yeah, you can achieve higher levels of yield in a fixed income context without dramatically increasing the risk. And I think that's something that most investors haven't been given the opportunity to do yet, because so many benchmarks and the products that track those benchmarks really just haven't been rethought. If it's true that the world is going to change the way that we think it will at B of A Research, then there's a bit of a rethink that still has to happen. It'll take time. But I think the good news for investors who are, I mean, look, anyone listening to an investment podcast like this one is already, you know, well ahead of many, many folks. And I think the chance to get into more parts of the fixed income market are really attractive here, especially after the kinds of increase in yields you've seen in recent months and years. So to achieve a higher level of yield actually takes some of the heat off of equities as well. You don't have to chase equities at high valuations to try to get more capital return because you're not getting the kind of income that you expected from your bond portfolio. That was a dynamic we saw even before COVID. Even at the institutional level, you know, professionals would, from multi-asset funds, maybe sometimes pensions or endowments would get into trouble with this. They would say, well, fixed income can't get it done for us, so we're just forced to go into overpriced private equity or venture capital or growth stocks or whatever to get capital gains. That's a terrible thing to be forced into if you don't want to be. So I think that relieving some of that pressure through higher yield in the fixed income side can solve a multitude of problems.
So you can still do 60-40, just kind of with a different approach in those various buckets. I wonder, you mentioned Fallen Angels, which I love Fallen Angels. We have a strategy on that, obviously. But are you concerned at all about credit exposure there in case of a recession?
Absolutely. It's a very important topic because what you're getting rid of, the interest rate risk, on the one hand, you're taking on a different kind of risk. I mean, there's no almost kind of like a fundamental law of conservation of risk or something. You're taking risk somewhere, inevitably, in markets. What I'm suggesting with this kind of prudent yield idea is to take less interest rate risk, less inflation risk, and take more credit risk. That means that in a recession or in a broad bear market, those assets will be under more pressure. For some rare investors who are able to ride that out, that's fine if you can handle the mark-to-market volatility. But most people can't do that. I can't do that. I mean, it's difficult to watch assets lose value and do nothing, you know, forever. Our solution to that is a very simple, and there's many other solutions you could do, but one solution would be use a simple trend following or momentum type of an indicator as a tool to make a few changes. And so we published some work on this. If you use the equivalent of a 200-day moving average, just about the most basic technical indicator that there is. I'm not a technician. I have great respect for folks who can find, you know, worthwhile tools, but taking the most basic indicator that anyone has ever heard of, you know, 200-day average, check in once a month. If an asset's trading below its average on a total return basis, well, the trend following 101 book would say it's time to get out or even go short. We don't need to go short, but you can get out. You can sell at that point and go to treasury bonds. If treasury bonds are trading below their average, well, don't go there. Just go to cash. That very simple rule set, based on our work and all the normal disclaimers about back tests apply. No one's ever seen a bad back test. You know, all those qualifications apply. But the point is that if you use an indicator, even that simple, you've avoided the lion's share of the drawdowns of the mark to market, you know, pressure that you would otherwise have experienced in a bear market. I have achieved much higher levels of yield on that fixed income portfolio during the other 70 to 90% of the time that you're in a bull market. You can achieve greater normal, you know, returns in normal periods. If you can cut out some of the risk in a bear market, you end up with a total overall picture that actually looks much more stable than what we think is going to be the case in the future. And again, I want to emphasize, even if we're wrong about the broad macro picture shift from a 2% to a 5% world, even if we're wrong about that, this type of portfolio, higher level of yield, more diversified pools of risks, gives you much better returns even over the past 20 years when interest rates and inflation were incredibly low. That's kind of our default assumption, that we're wrong on the macro view. Does the math still work? If we're right, you know, if the future looks more like, let's say, 1900 to 1980, or even 1900 to the year 2000, when really things started kicking off in terms of globalization, then the return profile of the future could look much more favorable. The point is that volatility is with us. All the major factors that made the last 20 years such a Goldilocks period all seem to be reversing. These all contribute to an environment that's much more difficult, or at least much different from an investment return perspective than the last 20 years. It means that you should be invested more in value, more in inflation-friendly assets, less in the kind of the growth stocks and the deflation-friendly assets that have dominated returns over the past two decades.
So you laid out a pretty good long-term kind of scenario there, but I'm going to ask you anyway, in case there's anything else top of mind, something I typically ask guests is, it's an opportunity to, I'd love to kind of see what else is in your mind in terms of what you're thinking about, but the question being, what's one long-term trend you see playing out over the next year or several years?
One thing that I think will be interesting to watch is the rotation that we expect to see from what you could call the virtual back to the real. For much of the 20th century, the real economy, you know, the industrial sector, materials, energy, those three sectors combined often accounted for 40 or even 50% of the market cap of the S&P 500. Then, as we've said, you had this boom, the productivity boom, electricity, and then computers, the internet, and so on. Why would you ever have brick and mortar retail dominate in a world when you can order online? I don't suggest that we're ever returning to that sort of retail business model, but I do think you could see a rotation away from the growth sectors, the virtual economy, given the valuations today, and back toward the real economy. So I think structurally a rotation, a rebalancing away from the virtual toward the real, from the digital to the atomic and so on is in the cards. These high costs of capital, not asset light, but asset heavy business models are relatively more expensive to run, can be more cyclical, more volatile. They also provide cash flows in the present rather than far out into the future. Something that investors, I think, will come to appreciate more than they have in recent decades. People don't bat an eye at buying equity in a business that doesn't expect to have profits, sometimes even revenues, for many years out. Yes, there'll be a total addressable market of $20 trillion, 20 years from now, or whatever the projection might be. And people will commit capital to that because they're so desperate for relatively scarce opportunity for profit. And I understand that. I think you should probably do some of that no matter what in a portfolio. Growth is a valuable factor. But value has been ignored, I think, for far too long. And not just in the abstract sense of factor investing, but in the sense of actual cash flows that come to you, today. Those are valuable. And I think that investors will place much more value on the kinds of cash flows that come to you in a steady basis now that can either be reinvested, paid out to shareholders, used to pay down debt, whatever it might be. That free cash flow is worth much more than it has been treated as being, I think, for some time. And if these broad economic sectors rebalance the way that we think that they might, free cash flow will be a part of that.
So I wonder if I can ask you about a few topics. It's our trend or fad segment. I'll get your quick take on a few things. All right, let's see where we are. Cryptocurrency, trend or fad?
Fad. Digital assets, maybe there's something there.
Labor strikes, trend or fad?
Trend.
Defense spending, trend or fad?
Trend. All day.
Yeah. Buffer ETFs, trend or fad?
Fad.
Interesting. And then finally, Speedos at U.S. beaches, trend or fad?
God, a fad, I hope. I
don't know. Yeah, me too.
Is it a fad? I've been sheltered at our local spot, but heavens.
It's coming back from some articles I've read. I haven't seen it. I haven't been to the beach lately, but I couldn't wear one, it's all right. Hopefully it is. Awesome. Well, Jared, thank you so much for being on the show. Really appreciate your time.
My pleasure. It's great to talk to you.
This is great. And thank you for tuning in to another episode of Trends with Benefits.